Is it not true that everything in the Christian faith that's fun is outside the church, and everything that's boring is in it? Is that not true of our present-day situation? You go to do something exciting, you join Campus Crusade for Christ, or InterVarsity, or Youth with a Mission.
What is your solution to this?
A torch well planted on the front doorstep of any church building on earth would be a good start. But that's a teeny bit radical. Doing away with Campus Crusade, InterVarsity, and Youth with a Mission is a suggested possibility. Is it not true that most of the fun you've ever had as a Christian has been outside the church, and all the boring stuff has been in it?
Yeah.
And is it not true that most of your touch with Jesus Christ has been outside the church, somewhere else?
Yeah.
What a shame. Boy, she is better, beautifuler, more glorious than the church building, Sunday morning, Campus Crusade, InterVarsity, and Youth with a Mission, and Young Life, and Youth for Christ, and all. You got any more? Let's do them all in here. Sorry, I love all you people. You're wonderful Christians and all that. But you ain't got a shred of New Testament to back up your existence. And the church has got no business being boring.
Amen.
And I'll tell you something else she's got no business being, and that is a violin with only one string.
That's right.
Let me just tell you what I mean by that. Go into any group and they're stuck on one way of meeting, no matter what it is.
Amen.
It's either glory, or it's praise, or it's worship, or it's classical singing, or it's a certain kind of preaching. The word versatility doesn't seem to exist in the Christian vocabulary. Variety seems to be a word that is a world beyond us. Whatever happened to versatility and variety? And part of this is your fault. Hey, you lack one kind of meeting, and you'll play that thing till it's dead. And then you'll take it out and bury it and play it at its own funeral. You were going to say something, brother.
Or we get stuck on one person.
One person, an individual, you mean. Yeah.
Leader, pastor,
okay, and that's not necessary. And I'm going to propose to you, when we tear that wall out here in a minute, and we're going to gently deal with this wall here behind us, I'm going to propose to you that the first century church had a different way of approaching everything than anything that we do today. There is not a... There is not a pattern in the New Testament. If we have the mind of Aristotle, we will call it a pattern. But if we have the mind of the Lord, we will see that this is something that is innate, natural, organic, and biologically impossible to stop. Just like your nose on your face, it just grows there by nature. There is not pattern. There is the organic. So I am going to give the Hebrew religion a little problem here for a minute. You'll forgive me, please, but I'm shooting everybody else. I might as well shoot the Jews. Right now, we are just so interested in Russia and Israel. I don't know why we're so fascinated with those two places.
But we go back to the Holy Lands, and I went there when I was 19 years old. And I have kept up with the archaeology of that land, and I know her traditions. And I know what people are speaking of. But without our realizing it, we get the idea in our heads that so much of our Christian faith is traced back to the Hebrew religion. I beg to differ with that. Now that's a far-out statement. But my faith has its roots not in the Hebrew religion, but in the Godhead.
Well, but he became a Jew, Gene. Yes, I know he became a Jew. But long before he was a Jew, he was God.
Amen.
And long before he was a Jew, he was. He existed. He had personality. He had thought. He had a habitat. He had a place where he lived. He had ways of thinking and conceptualizing. He had a mission. He came to earth to do it. His culture did not hinder that, nor did it greatly influence it. He was against his culture, had given the Hebrew faith, and it reflected much of his mind. Nonetheless, he appeared, and he brought the mind of God. And he brought more than the mind of God. He brought the experience of the Godhead. When he walked on this earth, he also walked in the heavens at the same time. When he walked on this earth, he had the ideas and thoughts that he had in an eternal, eternity past, call it in our terms, billions of years, but an eternity past experience in the Godhead. That's what he brought. His idea of gathering 12 men together with him was not Hebrew. It reflected something that happened to him in the Godhead. When he talked of spirit and truth and reality, he was speaking of something from another realm, not from things that had picked up in the Hebrew religion. The Hebrew religion was not guiding him. He had given that religion, and it had elements in it that reflected his mind. But now he brought his mind to this earth. I do not take away from the Hebrew faith. But it's not our origins. It's not our headwaters. God is our headwaters.
Amen.
Christ, the eternal Christ, the Christ of the Trinity, the eternal, everlasting Christ who came and became a man in the form of human flesh, in the likeness of human flesh. That one spoke from past experience. And what the 12 apostles got was a touch with that eternal past thing. And what you see happening in Israel, in Judea, in Galilee, is a reflection of what happened in him, in God. Does the Bible not call him an apostle? Does the Bible not call him the founder of our faith? Does it not call him the foundation of our faith? And the cornerstone of our faith, and the topstone of our faith, and the building in which we are in. He's everything of our faith. But I want to go back to this thing, apostle. He, Jesus Christ, is the author of the first church. He raised up the first church ever raised up on this planet, and he began new. And this is the establishment, we're talking about how to meet. This is the establishment of that, a radical break. We don't go to the synagogue to find the roots of the Godhead's fellowship or how the Godhead met. We don't go to the temple to find the roots of how the Godhead fellowship and how the Godhead met. The first church that ever existed, existed in the fellowship of the body of the Godhead.
Amen.
There is the origin of the church. He brought that to the dusty roads of Galilee with 12 men in personal, informal fellowship with them around him. He was the source of that fellowship. It was Christ. It was not singing. It was not worship. It was not theology. It was not teaching. It was not mission. It was not movement. It was not motive. It was not vision. It was him.
Amen.
They were possessed with him.
Amen.
And they learned church life gathered around the Lord Jesus Christ and nowhere else.
They learned how to meet around him. They learned how to fellowship around him. He wasn't singing. It was Christ. It wasn't worship, it was Christ. It wasn't ritual, it was Christ. And he gave to them an element, a chip, out of the Godhead's, the fellowship of the Godhead. That's what they touched. In the dusty roads of Galilee, and in living rooms where they sat around and listened to him talk and ask him questions, and fell asleep on his breast. It was totally informal. It was utterly without ritual. And it was Christ. And that was the church he founded. It was the first. No, it was the second church. The first one was the Godhead. The second one was this embryonic experience in Galilee and Judea. And until you can get obsessed with that, possessed with that, enamored with that, drunk on that, driven by that, then you and I both are wasting our times here. And you ask one of the apostles, what is the church? They hardly even understood the concept. But they understand sitting around with the Lord and fellowshipping with him. In some way, on the day of Pentecost, they were able to broaden that fellowship to 3,000 people. It started out with three, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. It enlarged to 12, 13, 14, 15. How many? 12, 13, 14, 15. Actually, of course, you know it's larger than that. There was Joanne, and there was Mary, and Mary Magdalene. And who was the other lady?
There were 70.
And there were 70, and I don't know who they all were. One of them was probably Silas. And another one was, what was the other guy's name? Matthias? Those are two we know for sure. There were 70. There were probably around 100, 150 people around him. And they were all touching the life of God. I'm telling you, all the elements of everything I want to say for the rest of this meeting have already been said. Element. It takes a church planter. And it takes a church planter who will leave. He is by nature itinerant. And that's what Jesus Christ was. And by the way, he left physically. And everything became internal. And all of the elements are there. Now, as I grow older, I marvel at what the Lord did when he chose those 12 men. May I get off the subject here at the very beginning and tell you that I'm
learning something, and this is what I'm learning, and that is that I want you all to listen to this, because this is understanding for me that's new, and I don't really get a whole lot of new insight as I go along in life. My commitments and visions and understandings have been clearer, but there's one thing I missed. Recent psychological studies of sociological studies of individuals has proven something. I don't like what I'm about to tell you, but it's turning out to be absolute truth that leadership is genetic. Boy, I hate to say that. That just galls me. It's genetic. You got it, you got it, you ain't, you ain't. Now, a brother said to me, but Gene, when we get saved, is there not a divine genetic? And I think there is. Because I don't feel like I was ever a leader. But I am learning that leadership in the church is a very, very rare thing. And I can tell you, there's another sin of tribe behind it, and that is everybody thinks he's one of those rare things. And he wants to be made one of those people. And I want you to know something. I don't know why you people are sitting in this room watching me and listening to me. I have no idea why. I don't feel like a leader. But I have faced, and it's taken me years, and I'm still having to, I wrestle with every day. I don't like leaders. My brother was a leader. He only had one follower, and he was by protest. Well, he was a leader. He wasn't a leader, he was a demagogue. He was an outright dictator. He was and he led me. And man, I fought every inch of it. I don't like leaders. I marvel at God's choosing of 12 men who can lead. And they are rare. And I am driven more and more to believe that in one lifetime on this earth, we will rarely ever see over 10, 15, or maybe 20 church planters
in a century. All nations combined.
I may be off 100. I don't think so. But if I'm off 100, it's 100. 100, 120. I haven't found them. You want me to tell you all the church planters that I know that have risen on this earth in this century? I can name them to you so quick. Watch me, Bok Sing and Prem Pradom. That's only three I am absolutely certain of. And that's in this century. What about these guys who started these movements?
Uh-huh.
That's my whole point. A church planter will not start a movement. He's more humble than that. No matter how arrogant he looks, he's more humble than that. I have been able to count 17 in the first century. And that was, per population of the planet, that's an all-time high. There are not many of them. But the Church of Jesus Christ is suffering from lack of them, and the Church of Jesus Christ is suffering from the lack of people seeing the desperate need of them. And I'm telling you, I don't want to tell you this. I wish I could give you a simple way of talking about this. I started this conference out by saying to you that what we're going to talk about may take 100 to 200 years. I want to repeat that. It may take that long before we see this have any roots. Until we get back to the concept of church planters, we're not going to get anywhere, saints. And I have to say to you that church planter is itinerant. He will not stay in one place. If he does, he'll goof up everything. He'll mess up everything. And he's rare. I would like to say he ought to be fallen, but boy, I tell you, most of the men who fly under the flag of apostle or church planter are just frightening people who will destroy your life. And they are usually leaders, but they are going to have a movement. They are arrogant men who are going to have a movement. Jesus Christ turned over to the world and left. He turned over everything to 12 men. And their concept of the Church of Jesus Christ at a meeting was Jesus Christ and them sitting around with him, fellowshipping with him. That was their concept. And the concept of worship was not there. The concept particularly of sharing was not there. The concept of preaching was not there. The concept of Christ was the main thing that they had in their minds. Can you please grab hold of that? And there were 12 men who had the ability to do what he did. I used to think he just took the common, but Jesus Christ looked into those men's lives and he found some kind of leadership that almost never emerges on this earth. And he worked with those men. He broke them. He broke their natures. And then he used them. May the Lord forgive me. I got saved when I was 17. I was preaching when I was 18 before I ever surrendered to preach. That's what Baptists do. By the time I was 20 years old, I was living in Europe, and I and a fellow by the name of Knut Quester. He was an Austrian. The seminary gave us a car to use on weekends, and we went out and we started Baptist churches in southern Germany. And that's what I was doing at the grand old age of 19. And when I became a pastor at the age of 21, I was going out opening doors of abandoned church buildings while I was pastoring and going out farmhouse to farmhouse in East Texas, gathering up the people who used to belong to churches that were abandoned and starting those churches over again. When I was 24 years old, I won a contest, $1,000 or a trip to Hawaii. I gave the money to Campus Crusade for Christ. I gave it to Bill Bright, who was a dear friend of mine. At the age of 24, I won a nationwide contest. First place, how to evangelize the world in one generation. And it was on the concept of church planters. And I didn't even know it. I didn't use that term. I was driven almost from the day I was saved. I've been at one job my whole life. I haven't changed it. And I meet young brothers and young students. Every once in a while, a sister who wants to be a church planter. And I ask you two questions. How big is your library? And how long can you stay gone from your wife? And the library is usually about 4 books long. And they can stay away from their wife about 3 days. Well, forget it, buddy. Until you can live in the fires of perdition. and eat it for supper, eat it for breakfast, eat it before breakfast. If you can take unmitigated persecution, misunderstanding, rumors and betrayals and everything else, if you can walk out and say goodbye to your wife for 3 to 6 months, and if your whole body, soul, and spirit is consumed with Christ and His church, then maybe, maybe that is your call. But I would say I meet a man at least once a week who wants to be an apostle. And I'm using the word church planter because I don't like the word apostle and I'm not comfortable with it and I don't even believe it fits. That's the first century thing, but those men's major job was planting churches. And that's what Jesus Christ did. That's what He did for a living. He planted churches. He planted one. And that was in the hearts of 12 men. And then came those 12 men and they planted a church. And then they left that church. Actually, the church left them. In that one rare case, the church left them. They stayed in hiding in Jerusalem, standing for some principle, I suppose. The church left them, but the church was without them. And again, the divine principle. It's not a pattern. It's not human. It's not organization. It's not a concept. It's the way divine life operates naturally, like human life grows a nose on your face. There is a world of difference. Until you won't, until you begin to pray for, until you ask God to raise up again church planters, we're stuck on how to meet. We're not going to have those meetings. You and I are going to sit here and suffer till the end of time. And those men have got to know what they're doing. And one of the things they do is they leave. And those churches, those people left the apostles and went out into Judea. And here is the most important thing I can say to you tonight, and that is those churches had a period of time when they had no leaders. And I've got to lay this thing down. The reason you can't meet in your group and never will successfully is because you began with leaders. I've never quoted this man before in my life. Ronald Reagan said something recently that was quite interesting. He said, all the other constitutions of the world start out, we the government. Only America's constitution starts out, we the people. And that's the way the church of the living God has got to be born, we the people. It's got to belong to her. It doesn't belong to the apostle. There's no church in the New Testament. The church of the Apostle Paul. It's the church of the saints, and it's the church of Christ. It's the church of God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's the church of the holy ones, and those are the only ones who own it. It's not elders. It's not apostles. It's people, and a church has got to be born without leaders.
Amen.
And she's got to have leaders later. But the church has got to feel that she has a franchise on the meetings. That the franchise does not belong to the pastor. It does not belong to the apostle or the elder. It belongs to God's people.
Amen.
Until we have that, we get nowhere. You are the church. And the church belongs to you. Now, in the beginning, that can get very, very confusing.
Somebody goes, well, what are you doing here then? The church belongs to us. We're going to follow nobody but Jesus.
Boy, you better follow the church planner. You're headed for nowhere. You are headed for nowhere. For one simple reason. You don't know how to be the church. You don't know how to meet. You're not going to learn. And you're going to die. I got a standing bet that no group of Christians, no matter how glorious they started or how wonderful they think they're going to make it, no group of Christians is going to make it 3 years without some outside help.
It's got to be with a church planter that is divinely ordained. That church planter has got to leave. That's divinely ordained. And that church has got to have a time without leaders. That's divinely ordained. You don't start the church without leaders. You'll die. Don't be so doggone idealistic. You'll never get anywhere. You begin with
the church planter, he leaves. Now we got two problems. We ain't got no church planters, and we ain't got nobody who'll leave. They all stay, doggone their hides. Say amen.
Amen.
And they ask you to support them all the rest of their days, now and forever, world without end. Now, I was standing here between the meetings talking to some brothers about why some brothers said we tried to change. Well, I hate to be part, and forgive me, I am not suggesting that you're in your group. I'm suggesting you go home and start over again. But I am telling you that's not the best way. The best way is to begin with a church planner. But I'm talking pure theory. Pure, unadulterated theory. I'm talking about that which we should pray for. And you Americans, doggone you, you need to pray for something else. And that's to get some of this democracy out of your bloodstream. There is such a driving concept among Americans, I ain't going to follow nobody. Who do you think you are? And you're cutting off, you're just destroying the church and all the hope of it. You need a church planner. He needs to get out of there, or you need to leave him, one of the two. And you've got to have a time when there are no leaders and the church understands that the meetings are totally her responsibility and she's got to carry them. Then you can have your elders, and then you can have your whatever else comes. And the gifts and all that stuff that you Pentecostals chafe after all the time. You've got to have the recovery of the gifts. You don't need the recovery of the gifts. You need the recovery of the centrality of Jesus organically. You're trying to have a nose and a foot and a leg and an arm before you have a baby. You're trying to have a tongue and a mouth and an ear and an eye before you have a child. The gifts come after the church. The church only needs one gift, and that's the gift of the church planter. And he gives the church. And the church has the church. And the church grows and matures, and it will produce gifted men with the gifts. The earliest churches had only two things, apostles and people. There weren't nothing else. I tell you, I know you all are following me perfectly, but you have a little, excuse me, I'm an old man now. I get frustrated. You walk out the door and you forget. I'm telling you, you're working in an untenable situation. I'm supposed to say all this at the end of this message, but I haven't even made my point yet. But I'm going to say it to you now. We got this kind of church. Here are the kind of churches we got on this earth. We got churches led by a multiplicity of priests. That's Roman Catholic. We have Protestant churches by pastors. And then you got churches outside the organized church. And what you've got there is either a one-shot apostle or what I would call an elder's church.
What we generally have is a man who was a young man, was a member of a group outside the organized church. He got very, very hurt. He had some years of resting. This is very generalistic. And then later he starts a little informal group. And you join it. And he's not a pastor. Actually, he has the gift of eldership. But he doesn't have the gift of church planting. And maybe he still has a job. But all he can do is raise up one little church. Now, let me put it this way. He can't leave his wife for 6 months. And he's not obsessed. If you please, he's not possessed. He's perfectly happy to have an informal gathering of Christians in his or somebody else's home running 20, 30, or 40, or 50 in the church. That's not going to turn the world upside down, saints. I thank God for it. Most of us are in elders' churches. One-shot apostles. You understand what I mean by that? They can raise up one church. That's it. Maybe in a lifetime they'll raise up two. But they're not madmen. I'm telling you, we got to have madmen. The apostle is the I'm sorry, forgive me. I don't mean that word. I don't like that word. And I don't believe in that word. The church planter is the one thing that fights the matrix. He is the one thing that stands against the culture. He stands against your natural lethargy. He is opposed to all that you are. Most of you in this room have a home. You have a job. You have an home, you have an job, you have an family, and you're going to live in an town for the rest of your life. And he can't sit still 5 minutes. And he is opposed to culture.
and he changes everything every week or two. He comes in through, and y'all hate to see him come, and he comes in with all his mad ideas and his hollering and his screaming and his telling you this and his telling you that and talking real radical, and he helps you, and then he leaves. While he's there, he tells you that all the young men should never marry and all the young women should never marry. See, he's nut. He was a stark, raving screwball. He's a nuttier than a fruitcake. His name is Paul of Tarsus. He is in defiance of the second law of thermodynamics. He does not believe that all things should come to wind down, cool off, and come to a dead standstill. God put him on this earth for that purpose, and you've got to have him. Otherwise, you end up with an elder's church. And I love him. I thank God for him. There must be thousands of them across the face of this earth. But they are one of the reasons our meetings stink. And you who are those kind, and I hope I don't offend you, those of you in this little black box here on this tape, I'm sorry, but I cannot be faithful to the scripture without saying to you, you are actually as in an untenable situation as a pastor is. A pastor has no scriptural right to exist, neither do you. But then, we don't have any church planners either, do we? So I don't know what to say to solve this problem, but I'm going to present to you the problem. And that's what this message is all about, is the problem. The problem is we don't have any church planners. Let me go through this real quickly. The apostles later went out and visited those churches. I don't know how they met, and I don't really care. I know that there was awesome dynamic there, but I know those 12 men. Those 12 men, their central message was Jesus Christ. It was not theology, and it was not worship, and it was not meetings. And they were restless men. They traveled their whole lives. They could not stay in one place. They were driven men. They were mad. They were not like ordinary people. And for me to talk this way is new for me. It's taken me to live this long to recognize the fact that most Christians, you, standing in this room, sitting in this room, like to live where you do. And you're going to enjoy living there. And I'm conceding that for the first time in my life. A few of you will be willing to move around once or two or three times in your life, and then you come back later and get real mad and say, "Oh, hell no, I'm holding that town. You talk me into going to that other place." So, you know, you're up to two or three moves. Me?
Right, those guys were like that. Peter drug his wife around with him, but he didn't go.
Now then, Paul of Tarsus and Barnabas, what's the pattern? The churches, for a time, have no leaders. Paul and Barnabas go into a city as church planters. They are itinerant men. Do you understand the itinerant? They're moving constantly. They go into a town, they stay a while, and they leave. They do not ordain elders. Do not read the scripture that way. That is unfair to the scripture. They do not choose elders. Those churches have no elders. Those churches have nothing but an apostle, and he's missing. And the meetings become theirs after a time in which that church planter planted, built, and showed those people what to do. Later, there are elders. And there are few men living today or who have ever lived who are willing to walk off from a church and leave it without leadership. Because their ministry cannot produce in a short length of time that which is necessary for a church to be left alone. They don't have a gospel that'll handle a situation like that. Four churches they went into, four churches they left, they came back and ordained elders, but you couldn't take those meetings away from God's people by then. Do you understand what I am saying to you? Right. That those people were addicted to being their own, in charge of their own meetings. Right. Get this and get it clear, the meetings belong to God's people. If there were 50 elders in that church, it didn't matter. The meetings belong to the Christ and God's people, and that's where they belong, and that's how a church is to be planted. And until we do this business of how to meet is dead in the water. Now I'm going to tell you what to do when you go home, but I am telling you the highest way and the best way and God's way, and the way that was born not in Israel and the Hebrew faith and not in the methods of men, but born in the Godhead and born out in Galilee with Christ in the 12, and then exemplified by Barnabas and Paul, and Paul and Silas, and Timothy and Titus, and Secundus and Tychicus and Trophimus and Gaius and Aristarchus. And I got one more, Epaphroditus.
was borne out by those men a consistent but divine heavenly pattern. A church, leave it. Let it become the possessor of the meetings. And then, elders, you can't take the meetings away from a God's people once they've got them. That was the pattern of the first century church, and that's why it could have incredible variety, and that's why it did not need a clergy. And that's why ordinary and even sometimes illiterate men and women could lead those churches. Because the churches, the cutting edge of the church's experience was the church belongs to us and the meetings are ours. I'm going to add one other element. We'll come back to this. I still think I'm dealing with a mindset here that has to be cracked open. You're still thinking of a place where you go and meet. And that will never work. The church is not a place where you go and meet. And before you have meetings, you've got to have a church planter. And before you can ever have church life, you've got to understand that that church life includes community. That means living out of one another's, living with one another by one means or the other. The church is not a gathering. The church is a people, and it is a community. And you do not need meetings when a church is a community. You don't have to have them. The church is first a community, not a gathering. I'm going to close by talking about the word ecclesia, and we're all going to rush out of here real quick. The word ecclesia is really misunderstood. Why we go back to etymology for that word, I don't know. The first time it was ever used that is found in written language is that someone stood in a court square and called the people out for a gathering. And they took that thing and they've stuck that down our throats, theologians, for hundreds of years. The church is the called out ones. That is a bunch of foolishness. That's the etymology of the word. That's not the way the word was used during the days of the first century. It's not the called out that the emphasis is in. It is the gathering. And the gathering had a special meaning, and that meaning was not gathering to meet. It was the reassembling of Christ.
Amen. Amen.
It was the assembling, the putting together, the rector set being put together, the assembling together of Jesus Christ. Now you say, Gene, that's too much. That's right, so I'll say it again. It is the assembling together of his physical body that's left on this earth. There is community. There is the church planter. There is community. And there is the body of Christ. And then you begin thinking in terms of gathering and meetings. And until we see these things, we're going to always lead with gatherings and meetings, and it's going to sink the ship every time. Brothers and sisters, tomorrow morning we will talk about the nature of the church, and we will begin to see why we must gather. But before we see why we must gather, we got to see what she is. And that's what we're going to talk about in the morning. You want to hear? Probably a brother or sister in the church who really had a compassionate heart, who did lay their hands on people to heal them, and if they didn't get healed, kept on taking care of them anyway, and nurtured them and trying to do other things that would help them get well. That's a church healer. Probably couldn't read and couldn't write. Didn't have a tent. Didn't give invitations. Didn't take up offerings. Just some brother who probably sold fish in the marketplace. Pastor, teacher, probably could read and write. Someone who just had the natural ability to care for people, give them counsel. Somebody you just naturally turn to when you have a need. Someone who could also, from time to time, bring a word of teaching in the gatherings in a very simple way. Some local brother who just met the needs of people who needed someone to sit down and love them and care for them and guide them and give them some guidance. You know another one? I think the apostle is very clear, because he really takes center stage in the New Testament. There's no question he is center stage. He is the main character from Acts on. Prophet. I think anybody in the church was a prophet who could speak, who could share anything, was considered. I think any time anybody spoke, that was considered foretelling, prophecy. I think there were a few people. I don't know of anybody but Agabus.
who had the gift of telling the future. He was the original Pentecostal. He had drama. He was extra local. He traveled. He was a different kind of a creature. He was a true Old Testament prophet in the New Testament, and therefore the New Testament must have had a few of those people. But I'll tell you this. I don't think he was standing up saying you should marry him and you should marry her. And I have a word from the Lord that you should move tomorrow. Too many prophecies today, my brother, driving people crazy, and the young people are destroyed by it. Because they really, I had a prophecy set over me when I just got saved. It was such and such. This little boy is now 10 years later, he's 30 years old, and he's still trying to live it out. And it obviously doesn't fit. Some guys asked me what I thought about tongues and interpretations in the meeting. I don't know. Some say it was the ability to interpret another language. I can only tell you this. Whatever it is, it's for doing at home. I am absolutely certain of that. That is so clear in Scripture, it's to be done at home. And if you'll do it at home, it won't bother me a bit. If you let a meeting be carried away from it, you are doing the mistake of the Corinthians. And I don't know how we ever came up with any other interpretation of that passage. And I think all of us need to understand is that all the gifts were operating in Jesus Christ. And none of us will ever have that privilege. He is the gifts of the church, in fact. He is not the gifts, the operation of the gifts. He is the gifts. He is the gifts given to the church. He is the gift. The giver and the gift. But their understanding of church was not teaching or theology or healing any more than it was rebuking Pharisees. But they found that very interesting. You can tell that they did, but what their enjoyment was the Lord. What drew them was himself. He, the man, the Lord, the God. Was God in the Reformation? Is God in the charismatic movement? I am not a steward of the Reformation. Nor am I a steward of the Pentecostal movement, the charismatic movement, which, by the way, has been one of the largest things that's ever happened in church history. In 100 years, it has probably influenced Christianity as much as anything ever has. Can I dare say those things were none of the Lord? But I live today, and I'm a steward of today. I cannot go back to Azusa Street. I cannot go back to Smith Wigglesworth. Is that his name, Wigglesworth? In England, and be steward of the mess they made. I will tell you that the charismatic movement got off on the wrong foot. And I am shocked constantly that they have never taken steps to do anything about it. To this very day, they have not done anything about it. It was born with some horrible flaws to it. And it's, with all the good and blessings that have come, it's had those flaws ever since. Same thing is true of fundamentalism, which is also a recent movement. It still carries the character and nature of its founders. Very raspy, hard, lack of compassion. I am steward of my day. No, I would say the Lord is in it. I really would. No, I would definitely say that. Yes, ma'am. I really would. I think in each situation, you get something. And then we throw in the rest. When all these customs came, the things that they left out were unbelievable.